So welcome you all to the first, and I believe this is this semester the only colloquium of the Cognitive Science Department. We have a special guest today all the way from Jerusalem in Israel, Elvira Debona, Dr. Elvira Debona, sorry, is a Polonsky Academy Fellow at the Van Leer Institute in the Hebrew University of Jerusalem.
Yes.
Right. And she has published on the perception of music, and this is why I gave this sort of rather general title to the talk before I knew exactly what it was. But I think we're going to be in the same topic today. The topic is going to be the experience of space, an analogy between musical sound and environmental. For those of you that had an opportunity today to be at the seminar with Dr. Debona, sincerest apologies, my fault. I misinformed her about the order of events and the workshop talk that she had prepared for us. She thought was going to happen at 7. So she will be giving for those of you that were not at the seminar. Again, my apologies, but she's offered to meet with us again tomorrow if we want to go through the workshop slides. So if you're into that, let me know and we'll arrange it. I understand that the topic of her other talk, the one that didn't happen today in the morning, concerned more empirical work that's done on
auditory agnosia.
On
auditory agnosia.
So I'll shut up and I'll let Dr. Debona.
Thank you, Miao. So first of all, thanks for organizing this colloquium. I'm very happy to be in Poland, and this is the first time, and I hope that you will invite me again. So, but another thing is that for those of you who are in the workshop this morning, actually, it's going to be the same talk, but with a different experience, because you're going to properly hear the speciality of musical sound in this kind of environment. So I believe that it's not going to be exactly the same, and given that you have heard already some very interesting examples like the Parliament and the Matryoshka case, I'm sure that now you will have more chance to think about that, given that they are kind of somehow particular examples. So I'm going to talk about the experience of space, and I will start by saying how exactly we experience space through the sense modality of audition, and by individuating three different kinds of spatial experience. So I am interested in offering you an account of how exactly we experience space when we have an auditory experience. I will focus on environmental sounds, which are the sounds that usually surround us, namely people talking, a door slamming, a car in the street, nowadays, sounds. So I will focus on these specific sounds, but then in the end of the talk, I will try to apply the frame I have found within these specific environmental sounds within a musical example. So I will show you that with regard to the sound sources, we have the experience of space, which is similar between environmental sounds and musical sounds. So the question I will try to give an answer is, can we experience space in auditory perception? And if yes, how do we do that? So these are the two questions. Actually, the first one is considered to be rather a trivial question nowadays, because there are a lot of empirical data showing that we are quite good in locating sounds at a certain distance and at a certain location with regard to the listener. So actually, philosophers are not wondering again whether we experience space, because it is a truth that we do. So the question, the more interesting question is, do we have it? Okay, we don't. Okay, it's fine, it's okay. So the more interesting question is to give an account of how we do that. So how we experience exactly space through audition. And also this is the specific topic that contemporary philosophers of perception are really interested in the last years. So, but why I said that it is trivial? Because actually, as maybe you can imagine, for some philosophers, it has been not so trivial that we can have spatial experience. So people like Shaughnessy and Strawson thought that auditory experience is not so spatial as we think. So we can read in the second chapter of Individuals of Strawson that sounds, of course, have temporal relations to each other and may vary in character in certain ways, in loudness, pitch, and timbre, but they have no intrinsic spatial characteristics. And the italics is mine. I wanted to underline the specific words, namely intrinsic spatial characteristics. Such expressions as to the left of, spatially above, nearer, farther, have no intrinsically auditory significance. And again, we can read in Shaughnessy that while we have the auditory experience of hearing that the sound comes from P, we do not have any experience that it is here where it now sounds. And this is so for a very interesting reason, namely that we absolutely never immediately perceive sounds to be at any place. So we have in the literature philosophers who have been arguing against a spatial experience of sounds. And so actually they are labeled as the aspatial, so their theory is labeled as the aspatial theory of sound. But as I said before, we have good empirical data showing that we're good in locating sounds in a certain direction and distance just by reflecting on the phenomenology of our auditory experience. And of course we have massive, very seminal book on spatial hearing written by Jens Blauert, in which there are experiments showing how good we are. Of course, we can be how good we are in locating sounds. Of course, we can be wrong about that. So we can have illusion, hallucinations. But the point is that it always seems that we locate sounds somewhere. So maybe they are not there where it seems that we are locating them, but we always get spatial information through the sense modality of audition. Now then, the interesting question is then how we do that exactly, what kind of spatial information we get, and also, do we locate sound, another important question is, do we locate sound where sound sources are, so that sound and sound sources are heard as co-located. So once that we have said how we experience space through audition, we can further ask whether it seems that we locate sounds where sound sources are, so that they are somehow co-located. So why this question is important? Because again, in the contemporary debate, we have two different views. The distal view of sound, which answers affirmatively to this question, and the majority of philosophers embrace this view. So they think that when we have a veridical perception of the location of sound is because we are locating it where sound sources are. And then we have the medialists, who on the contrary claim that we have good reasons to think that we do not locate sounds at their sources. And so that sounds and their sources are not co-located. But the sounds are heard as traveling, like sound waves, therefore sounds would not share their location with their sources. Of course, we can have different metaphysical consequences depending on the view that we are into. So if we think that if you are within the distal view, so if we think that sounds are located where sound sources are, it means that maybe we think that sounds are some kind of vibrations of the sound sources, or like located events. So events located where sound sources are, or if we think that medialists are right, then maybe the metaphysical consequence is to think that sounds are maybe identical, or they supervene on sound waves. In my case, I tend not to to have some metaphysical conclusions, at least at this stage of my research. So I just do a kind of step back, trying to describe from a phenomenological point of view, from the way in which things appear to us, what kind of spatial experience we have when listening to sounds. But I just wanted to remind that depending on the account you're having, you can have very important metaphysical consequences. And these accounts are based on the kind of spatial account you are providing. Now, I wanted to start now by describing the different ways in which we experience space in sight and in touch. And actually, and this will be important, this will be a tool in order to show something about audition. So this philosopher, Mike Martin, wrote a paper in 1992 called Sight and Touch, saying that the way in which we experience space through vision is different from the way in which we experience space by touch. So we have different kind of spatial experience. So he asks us to focus on this example, which is the example of dopamine. So here we have a candy, which is a mint candy, which is called dopamine, exactly. So the dopamine case, you need to, for Martin, you just imagine to have this candy in front of you and trying to imagine what kind of spatial information you get by looking at it. It's a very easy example. So one, for Martin, one is aware of the various white parts of the mint arranged in a circle and aware of how they are related to each other also. One is also aware of the hole in the middle of the mint and that hole is there in the middle. One is aware of the hole as a place where something potentially could be seen, not as where something is actually seen to be. So we can think of normal visual experience as experience not only of objects which are located in some space, but as of a space within which they are located. The space is part of the experience in as much as one is aware of the region as a potential location for objects of vision. So I know that this is a demanding example, but we can summarize it saying that we experience space in three ways, namely by seeing the white parts of the mint which form the circle, then the white parts are related to each other, and third, we are aware of the hole in the middle as arranged as a circle and as a space which can be potentially occupied, so that can be virtually, they can virtually be occupied or empty. So we get also some information about the kind of space that we see in the middle of the parliament. Now, what about touch? For Martin, we experience space through touch in a different way from the way in which we do it by vision. So in the case of touch, he imagines to grasp a glass, a simple glass. So when one grasps the rim of a glass, one comes into contact with it at only 5 points. We imagine that we're touching it with 5 fingers, okay, not just 2 or 1. One, I think, is possible, but 3 or 4. Okay, so where one fingertip touches it. Nevertheless, one comes to be aware that the glass as a whole, is a circular. In being tactually aware in this way, is one aware of the parts of the rim in between the points of contact in the same way as one is aware of those points? And is one aware of the region of space lying inside the rim? The answer would appear to be not. One comes to be aware of the glass by being aware of the parts one touches. In this, it contrasts with the parliament, since one is aware of the ring surface and the hole in the same way. And also because, so in this case, in the touch experience, we do not perceive the hole of the glass as potentially being occupied or empty. So this is the big difference. Now, what about audition? Because, so why I suggested to have a look on this paper? Because NADS thinks that the way in which we hear space, so perceive space by audition, is very similar to the way in which we perceive space by touch, and different from the way in which we see space, so perceive space by vision. So suppose you hear, and this is his argument, suppose you hear two sound sources, one located in front of you on your right, and the other in front of you on your left. Now, NADS claims that you can be aware of the location of the two sources from right and from left, and also aware of the space between the two sound sources. So, while in vision you are aware of the spatial region occupied by the parliament, in addition you might be aware of the places where sound sources are. This is a kind of analogous. At the same time, as you see the space between the white parts of the parliament arranged as a circle, you might hear the space which separates the two sound sources. So they seem to be perfectly analogous. But there's a disanalogy, because auditory experience does not tell us anything about regions of space other than those where we experience sound sources to be. So if you experience the source of a sound to be over on your right and another source to be over on our left, then we are aware of that being separated by a region of space, and our experience represents the spatial relation between them. But our experience does not tell us anything about that space. In particular, it does not tell us whether there is anything at the places in between the places we hear the sources to be. It does not represent those locations as either occupied or as empty. So again, the example is that, so imagine to listen to two voices, which are two sound sources, and again, you can perceive, of course you perceive where they are located, which is similar to the spatial region that you, in which you see the parliament to be. So you perceive like also the space between the two sound sources, but differently from the visual case, in the auditory case, it seems that you cannot hear that space as a virtually empty or occupied. So you cannot get information about the kind of space which is between the two sound sources. So what I'm suggesting, so this is Matthew Nutt's account. I don't agree with that, so I'm trying to show that there is a way also in addition to perceive a space as a virtually occupied or empty, so that we have an analogous case in addition to the parliament case in vision. And yes, I'm suggesting to focus on the example of the Matryoshka doll. So imagine you have a Russian Matryoshka. The doll is located in front of you and on your left, and you have removed all the dolls inside it but one, let's say the medium-sized doll, like this one or this one. So you have the figure, Matryoshka, and inside it, this or this. So this is the situation in which you are. So imagine that someone shakes the dolls without that you are watching it. You're just listening to the sound which is produced by this action. So someone shakes the dolls, the external one and the medium-sized one inside it. So you will hear a kind of woody noise. So it is possible, by virtue of hearing this woody noise, to claim that by audition you perceive the spatial region where the dolls are located, so in front of you and on your left, for example. In addition, you might also hear the space between the external doll and the medium-sized doll, by virtue of, the sound you hear. So that you hear the space between the two sound sources, as in the case of the two voices. Moreover, by the sound you hear, you can also guess if the internal Matryoshka is the small, is the smallest one, or like maybe is the medium-sized one. Therefore, there is a sense for which you hear the distance between the big external Matryoshka and the medium-sized one. However, at the same time, if you try to shake the Matryoshka several times, and change the size of the Matryoshka which is inside, you can also experience the space within the Matryoshka itself as being variously filled. The different sounds you hear can tell you that there is a space which might be virtually empty or occupied, as in the case of the Parlement. As another example, maybe more common, imagine you have a box with tiny objects inside it. If you shake it, if someone shakes it for you, so that you don't do the action, so that you don't have information by touch it. So if you if someone shake it for you, you can tell whether the box is empty, filled, or half empty just by addition. So would this not be then a way to experience space itself solely through audition? We can conclude indeed that we do not only hear sound sources as having a location, but also that there is a way to hear sound sources being located in the same way in which we can see an object located in space. So I'm not claiming, of course, that our auditory acuity in perceiving space is comparable to our visual acuity. Of course, the two experiences differ in the determinacy with which they represent the location of the source. However, despite the fact that auditory spatial acuity is relatively poor, my examples of the Matryoshka doll is simply meant to show that, at least in the matter of the three modalities Nads listed as the ways in which we experience space and objects as located in space, audition is analogous to vision. So this is, if you agree with me, I've provided a way of experiencing space by audition. And I said that this is pretty much similar to the way in which we experience space through vision. Now, as I said at the beginning of the talk, we need to say something more. And precisely, so this is just a summary of what I said. But now, what I said at the beginning is that because I'm within the distal view of sound, I want somehow argue against the in favor of the idea that we can locate, we hear sounds as located where sound sources are, so that they share the same location. So I want to argue in favor of the co-location of sound and its sound source. And again, I'm kind of arguing against Nats, who thinks that it's not possible to say that we hear sound sources that we hear sounds where sound sources are, so that they are not co-located. And he starts by presenting again an example taken from vision. So he has a model taken from vision to say how we perceive objects as co-located. And he thinks that this model cannot be applied within audition. So the model is as follows. So imagine that you have a cube with a red cross on a surface of it. So it seems that you can perceive the cube and the red cross as two items which are co-located, which share the same location. And it seems that you can do it because three parameters are satisfied. So the first one is that the cross and the cube can be perceived as independent from one another. So they can be perceived as having two independent locations. The second is that each of them is perceived as having a location, like in general, as occupying a certain region of space. And third, that it seems that we see them as having partially the same location. So for Nads, this is a good model that can tell us how we perceive co-location in the case of vision. And for him, the first parameter is not something. And so, because we have these three desiderata, we can say that the red cross and the cube are perceived as co-located. In the case of audition, the first parameter cannot be met. Namely, so again, the example of audition is that we're talking about sensors and sound. So for Nads, we cannot perceive them as a co-located because there is no way for us to perceive them as having separated locations, right?
So this is his idea. I tend to say that, arguing against him, that this is not the only model for perceiving collocation in vision, because we can also perceive collocation, so like two objects as being collocated, as sharing the same spatial region, even if they are not perceived as having two different locations. So I just ask you to focus on this example, even if the picture is not really a good picture. So you just here, you need to imagine that instead of this bad picture, you have in front of you a book with a transparent cover sheet, like a yellow-colored transparent sheet. So this is, you can imagine that this is a good image of it, right? Okay, so imagine that you print out the manuscript of a book you have just finished to write, and instead of a hard copy of it, you prefer just to bind the pages in a cheaper way, namely by using a simple spiral, which we don't see it, but you just have a lot of imagination to imagine it, with a transparent cover sheet colored in yellow. Since the cover sheet is transparent, you can see the first page of your manuscript where the title of your book is written. Imagine that your book is Speciality and some sources, just below the transparent sheet. You can see both the transparent cover sheet as having a location and the first page of your manuscript as having a location, but you cannot say that you are able to perceive them as distinct items, having an independent location from each other. So would we say that we do not perceive them as a collocated? We would rather say that we perceive them as having both a spatial location and as being collocated, even if we are not able to detect their own spatial location. So my claim is that we hear sounds at some sources as collocated in the same way in which we see the collocation between the cover letter and the first page of the manuscript. When we hear sound sources as having a location, we hear tout court their sound as having a location. And since we cannot hear them as two separate items independently located, we hear them as collocated. So finally, since sound sources are distally located, we hear also sounds as distally located. Such model of auditory collocation can be easily applied to both non-musical and musical sounds. And now we're gonna see how, if you agree with me, if you think it's a good account of experiencing collocation, and if you think that I provided you a good way of getting spatial information by audition, just describing environmental sounds, now I'd like to show you how we can apply this model within musical space. So again, recall that the three modalities by which we can visually experience space are seeing the spatial region where objects are, seeing the space between the parts of which the object is composed, and also seeing the space between the places we see, which can eventually be perceived as occupied or empty, so that we can experience the space itself. This was the general framework I've just shown you. So what about now musical space? Exactly. So how we can apply this model to a musical example? So usually people have been working on a musical space, focusing on some aspects. So first, we can hear the space in which musical sound sources are located, and people have worked on this specific aspect, which is like my topic, because they found more interesting working on the way in which we experience the distance between the different pitches in the melody or the harmony, which constitute a musical piece. And finally, the way in which we can hear the distance between the different elements which are part of the rhythmic structure at the basis of the musical piece. So as I said, the majority of philosophers have focused on the second and the third kind of spatial experience, and often connected the experience of space with the experience of movement. Now, musical sounds, of course, have physical sources whose locations are to some extent perceptible. The separation of performers into distinct groups, quite specific, with specific indications given by the composer in the matter of their relative placement, has become quite common in the classical music from the beginning of the 21st century and had already acquired a certain importance in the 20th century. Charles Ives, for example, composed the first and the fourth movement of his fourth symphony, paying attention to special effects created by employing a specially separated ensemble of five violins and harp and a specially separated group of percussions. There are many compositions in contemporary music in which has been made a massive use of spatial direction as a compositional means. Examples which employ this technique are Intolleranza by Luigi Nono, Double Concerto Opus 27 Number 2 by Georgi Kurtag, and then Gruppen by Stockhausen, Articulation by Ligeti, and Fall, which is the second movement of a work of Jean-Claude Risset entitled Computer Suite from Little Boy. And again, we have other work by Stockhausen called Gesang der Jünglinge, Northheim Epitaphio, and Ives, Three Places in New England. I'm just saying that there are a lot of, in contemporary music, a lot of compositions in which space is important within the composition itself. So it's not just a matter of where you locate some sources, it's just that it is a feature of the composition itself. Now, let's now focus on a specific example. So, I'm not sure that all of you have the content of. So even if we go back to the polychoral music of the late Renaissance, we can find a composer like Giovanni Gabrieli, whose compositions had separated choirs put on opposite sides of St. Mark's in Venice in order to create spatial effects. Let us consider a composition taken from his sacred music. So Gabrieli used to write music to be performed in St. Mark's Basilica, which was renowned for its oppositional organs that inspired the style of separated choirs, which is a technique labeled also as the style of cori spezzati in Italian. This technique was based on two or more vocal or instrumental groups of musicians situated in opposite choir's lofts, alternating each other with an echo effect and playing together when reaching the acme of the musical piece. The essence of the polychoral music was to create music effects in which resonant sounds intermingled with the oppositely located sounds. In the motet in Ecclesiastes that you have in your handout from book second of the Symphonie Sacre, published in 1615, Gabrieli employs three choirs, a choir of voices, a choir of solo voices, and an instrumental group, all supported by an organ. This motet is constituted by the traditional Alleluia refrain, a sinfonia, and a grand climax, or climax, with solemn chords announcing the final session of the piece. Let us imagine to be in St. Mark Basilica. Imagine that this is not, this is St. Mark Basilica. Listening to a live performance of In Ecclesiastes, sitting right in the middle of that church, and see if the way in which we perceive the space when listening to Gabrieli's motet is close enough to the way in which we experience the speciality of sound in the Matrioska case. So we can try to listen to it, focusing attention to what I just said. Of course, yeah, you need to imagine that you are in that situation with a good resonance and like a kind of Dolby surround effect so that we don't have such a great... We have kind of lofts here, I see, so maybe we...
Alleluia, Alleluia.
Okay. Next time we will have like good Dolby surround effect. So why we listen to it exactly? I'm gonna now do the analogy with the Matrioska case. So again, just recall you that I said that in the case of environmental sounds, we perceive the spatial region where the dolls are located. That we share the space between the external Matrioska and the medium-sized Matrioska. And finally, if we shake the Matrioska several times and change the size of the Matrioska doll which is inside, we can also experience the space within the Matrioska itself as being virtually empty or occupied. Now, while listening to in ecclesis, as we just did, we can quite accurately image that you are in St. Mark. Of course, we can quite accurately hear where the different musicians are during the performance in many circumstances, as when playing the vocal solo parts. We listen to many moments in which there were just a countertenor or just a tenor singing. So, and these are the vocal solo parts. So when the entire, so we can also hear when the entire instrumental choir is playing, and when the vocal choir is singing a cappella. So that means without the organ. So that we can tell where musical sound sources are, like in front of you and on your left, or on your back and on your left, and so forth. Very often in the piece, there are pauses between the end of a session and the beginning of the next one. For example, the last session of the motet, of course I can provide you the scores if you want, so that you can see exactly what I mean by pauses and the different moments of the different musical elements in there. So very often in the piece, there are pauses between the end of a session and the beginning of the next one. For example, the last session of the motet, which is the climax of the entire composition, includes many of those silent moments, as when the expression Deus adiutor noster in aeternum is spaced out with many simultaneous pauses during which none of the musicians plays. Now, sitting right in the middle of St. Mark Basilica, when experiencing these moments of silence, in which the last played notes resonate before fading away, we would experience the space between the three choirs quite easily. Finally, when performing the Alleluia refrain, it is often the case that a soloist, a countertenor or a tenor voice alternates with the vocal groups. This effect between the two lines is construed thanks to a skillful use of tonal contrast and pauses, so that when listening to it, one would clearly hear the space between the choirs as being virtually empty and variously filled, especially during pauses again. So this is just a summary of what I said. Conclusion. So if one finds convincing the way in which I describe the speciality of sound sources by virtue of the Matrioska case, how I account for the collocation of sound and sound sources, and how I apply the Matrioska schema to the speciality of musical sound sources, and given that two is the core idea of the gist of view of sound, then I have shown how one can argue for this view, not only in the matter of environmental sounds, but also with relation to the musical sounds, in a particular kind of music, of course. Now, what I wanted to say here is that I wanted to add two more things. One is that within the literature on the philosophy of sound, as I said before, people are just caring about environmental sounds. So they have their theories, which can be the medial theory, the distal theory, which are based on how we experience only environmental sounds. So what an original point of my account is just trying to apply one of those theories, which is the distal view, in a specific musical example, which is something that I haven't seen in the literature. And second, another thing I wanted to add is that
I've provided an analogous way of experiencing space in environmental sound and musical sound, but it doesn't mean that the spatial experience that we have by listening to music is peculiar, is somehow particular, is different from the spatial experience that we have when listening to environmental sounds. It's just that maybe we have to have a look on other aspects. They are alike with regard to the experience of sound sources, as I described it, but I'm sure that they are quite different with regard to, for example, the spatial experience of notes in a melody, or of the different beats which compose a rhythm. So if we want to find differences between the auditory experience of space, we need to have a look on something specifically musical. And I'm sure that there are a lot of work that it needs to be done in order to account for this difference. In this case, I just wanted to say that they are analogous with regard to just sound sources. And this is at the end of my talk. Thanks for listening.